Good morning, you're watching Proactive London. Today joining us, we have the fund manager, Richard Woolnough from M&G Investments to discuss his view of the current economic trends and investing strategies.
Hello. There are two or three issues I want to focus on today. The first one is the nature of the economic drawdown we've had this year, and the nature of the collapse has obviously been huge. And the recovery has been huge. And so we'll go through explaining that and see what the implications are for next year. Second thing I want to talk to is about the valuation that's embedded in certain asset classes, predominantly in government bonds and risky assets like corporate bonds. These react dramatically when you have dramatic economic events. So when interest rates are needed to be cut, for example, when the economy slows. And when the economy slows, corporations, their probability of default, their ability to meet their finances, deteriorates. And this is reflected in prices on a stock-by-stock, sector-by-sector, and a general sort of market level. Obviously, people are very used to seeing that in the volatility that we see in stocks. But the same rules apply to government bonds and to corporate bonds and to high-yield debt. So there are areas we're going to be focusing on today. And talking about how the economy interacts with these instruments in the real world as it stands as we go into 2021. One chart we need to see, obviously, is the collapse in GDP. And this has been dramatic, the most dramatic in my time of working. And it's been driven by different reasons and is traditionally the case. Traditionally, GDP collapses because the central banks have tightened rates. There's trade wars, the oil price has gone up. There's been a financial bubble, whether it be tech or whether it be banking. This time round, none of those were present as we headed into the recession in 2020. This was more of a natural cause. It was COVID. So COVID resulted in a policy response. And this policy response involved reducing consumption of services. And when you look at the consumption of services versus the consumption of normal goods, this recession is very, very different from previous ones. For understandable public health reasons, service consumption has collapsed, and that has resulted in a general collapse in GDP. Either people are not willing to go out, or people not able to go out, or people are limited in how they can go out. So that's been a big change from previous recessions. A very, very dramatic thing to happen. Now, in previous recessions, we work out how do we get out of this. We get out of this because, industry adapts, the banking system gets rescued, the oil price falls, rates get cut. This time round, it's a lot more instantaneous. This time round, we know we come out of it when we're allowed to do the things we weren't allowed to do before. So when you are, happy and willing to travel on the plane, because when you get somewhere, there's somebody there willing and happily to put you in the hotel to entertain you, whatever the case may be. So when we come out of this, that is what's going to happen. There will be potential for a huge rebound. And this is what we've talked about over the time in the three blogs that we've written that have been instantaneous and contemporaneous with this particular outbreak. The first one talking about in the early stages of the crisis, talking about how dramatic the collapse would be and how big the rebound would be. The second one was early summer, where their first data came through showing that the rebound was being strong. And coincidentally, we sort of wrote the same time about how big the boost coming back will be. And finally, just recently, the third blog in the series talks about how strong the economy might be in 2021. Maybe more optimistic view than other people think. So the way we look at this is very different. We've termed this a T-shaped recession. It's a dramatic collapse in economic growth and a big rebound in economic growth. Now, where we get to on that rebound is quite interesting. Do we go halfway up? Do we go three-quarters way up? Or do we get the most exceptional rebound ever and you end up with a type of capital T, i.e. you get back to where GDP was before? Maybe a blip, but maybe we get towards that area. And that's one of the things we talked about the last time we wrote about this T-shaped recession. It is very, very different from previous recessions. And that is, as we explained, it's due to it being service curtailed as opposed to manufacturing led. So when do we get to that? When do we get to that beautiful place where, GDP can return somewhere near where it used to be before? It's pretty obvious the cause and effect. It's when the virus effects are mitigated. And that can be mitigated in the natural world in terms of, its outcome as it fades and wanes, as it works its way through the population and the virus becomes endemic as opposed to pandemic in its nature. And the other way is how human intervention works, a non-natural way. And that is we get involved. We work out better treatments. We work out better cures. We work out prevention. We work out vaccination. And we can come back onto a normal way of life and go back to where we were before. So this is the big driver of this. It's a big economic recession, big implication for interest rates, big implications for credit. Fortunately, this time around, because it's been a government policy, the government's reacted to this in a very aggressive and very fortunate way. The central banks, where they can, have cut rates. And governments have done a huge transfer of wealth from the private to the public sector, from the public to the private sector. And this obviously, whether it be through schemes to keep people employed, whether it be subsidising businesses, whether it be grants, whether it be loans, these things have given us a bridge to the other side, a bridge to when we can return more to normality, a bridge when either the virus is gone or we live with the virus in a less dramatic state or some combination of the two. Now, that's where we're getting towards. And that is what hopefully you'd expect to be happening in 2021 when we get through the second wave of this natural disaster. We had the first wave, a bit like a hurricane, as we went through the spring. We then get the eye of the storm in the summer where the virus dies back a little, as it seems to be very seasonal, like other similar viruses. And then finally, we've got this last wave to come as we go through the second part of this natural disaster that's occurring and affecting economic policy and economic growth. So, you know, that's where we're sat in terms of the shocks of the system and the potential rebound. And the key to why, you know, this rebound, it's been a T-shaped recession, very sharp down, very sharp back up again, is the nature of recession and the fact that government has thrown everything at it and governments around the world have thrown everything at it, whether it be monetary or fiscal policy. This comes back to one of the strange things about this recession. Obviously, the stock market, let's say in the US, is back at all-time highs. Credit spreads, investment-grade bonds, many of the investment-grade bond spreads that were available in January are not wider than they were in January. Actually, credit risk has tightened. Certain sectors have been hurt, obviously the ones that are more linked to the pandemic. But other sectors have performed quite well and actually record tights for the last 4 or 5 years, not record-wise. Very different from a normal recession where those bonds would be very, very wide. It is very, very different this time. And that is because, you know, it's seen as a very short-term recession. And when you're buying a long-dated asset, it's the income streams over the life of the asset that count, not the income stream today or tomorrow. And bondholders and equity holders and banks are working their way through to bridge this particular issue, to bridge it to the other side. And the capital markets and governments have worked together to cope with this particular, you know, interruption to cash flow. And that means that obviously the rate of default isn't as high as one might expect. And therefore, you know, that's reflected in asset prices and where corporate bond spreads are. There's been a very rational response to it in that we know what's caused it. We know vaguely when it might end and how it would end. And the government and the private sector, but particularly the government, has worked to push that through and get us through to the other side. One thing that's very different this time around in policy responses is the responses of the central banks. Normally, they cut rates aggressively. This time, they've not been able to because we're at the zero bound. And you can see that when you look at a chart of where short-term interest rates are, the ECB, the Bank of England, the Fed, and they've cut rates, but it's de minimis. And in fact, in some cases, like the ECB and the Bank of England, you can hardly notice it on the charts. When you're at the zero bound, it's very hard to have negative rates. Again, something we talk about regularly. The idea of putting your money in a bank deposit at a negative rate isn't particularly attractive. And therefore, the banking system sort of grinds to a halt when you get into that sort of absolute or near the absolute zero. Something that all central bankers recognise, whether it be the ECB, whether it be the Bank of England, or whether it be the Fed, you know, the banking system ceases to operate in its traditional manner when rates get towards zero and people have a choice of earning cash in hand that doesn't depreciate, are putting their money in the bank that does depreciate. Obviously, that causes the banking system some issues compared to its traditional model. So when you're at that zero rate, what happens is central banks still help. They intervene. They buy corporate bonds. We've written about that. You know, that's a very, very important way to keep liquidity flowing. They lend money through special programs. And they do quantitative easing. They buy long-dated bonds and they put lots of cash into the system. These are all very positive things in terms of stimulating economic growth. But what also happens this time around is because we started at such a low rate, because we started with rates so low, it meant that the normal huge rally you have in government bonds didn't occur. And again, when you look at a chart of 10-year German bonds, 10-year UK bonds, 10-year US bonds, the ones that were the furthest from the zero bounds had a substantial bull market. The ones near the zero bound couldn't really get there. And this is a very important reflection when you look at analysing securities. You can look at something and you say what might happen to it, but you have to look at the risk reward for it. And when you're at the zero bound, it's very, very hard to see how you get negative interest rates. So imagine there are two very simple scenarios. One is the economy continues to be weak. Let's go and buy some bonds. They'll perform very well. But actually, you know, it's very hard for them to get through zero. Japanese bonds have been negative over this period because they're already at the zero bound. Let's take the other economic scenario where the economy bounces back. Well, rates go up, inflation goes up, the economy is recovering. So you have downside. So when you're faced with an upside being limited, a downside being less limited, even if you have no view, it pushes you towards maybe not owning that particular asset class and avoiding taking those kind of duration risks. It's something to bear in mind when you're looking at a risk-free asset like a government bond. Secondly, the other thing that's happened through this is that you have a situation where central banks have recognized they want to escape this zero bound. They want to get away from this problem. How do they get away from this problem? A classic way would be to print money, but it's not the job of the central bank to print money in some ways, because if they print it, they've got to work out who they give it to. And that's very much a political decision. I think the way you get away from the zero bound is actually for central banks and governments to work together so they can monetize the debt, they can print the money, and then governments and politicians and democracy can decide where that money should go, as opposed to being leaving it in the remit of a central bank, which doesn't have that political angle to work for. So what I think is going to happen this time next year is hopefully, with through this virus, hopefully through it's naturally waning and through man-made efforts, and hopefully this time next year, you know, central banks and governments continue to press the button for growth. Unlike previous recessions where they've gone for, let's pay the bill, let's pay the money back, whether that be through fiscal restraint or whether that be through tightening interest rates, this time, both the governments and the central banks want to escape the zero bound. They want to make up for lost consumption. And therefore, going forward, when normally you can manage a recession, immediately, when's the next depression going to occur? When they're going to tighten fiscal? When they're going to tighten monetary policy? This time round, I think the political and the economic appetite is for growth. And so when we come out of this, they will continue to be fiscally generous. Central banks will continue to run a very loose monetary policy. And this is with the explicit aim of keeping growth high, and keeping inflation higher than it's traditionally been. I think that's the scenario we should look for over the next 2 or 3 years. You know, when we're through this virus, hopefully sooner rather than later. And secondly, when we are through, it won't be let's get back to normal, let's get the fiscal deficit under control, let's get back to normal, let's return monetary policy back to normal. It'll be we need to do a lockstep change in fiscal and monetary policy and boost growth. Hopefully with that, you'll find that in the accompanying charts we've done for the presentation of interest, and look forward to talking again next year. Thank you very much.